Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Just then, a lawyer stood up to test Jesus. "Teacher," he said, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus said to him, "What is written in the law? What do you read there?" The man answered, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself." And Jesus said to him, "You have given the right answer. Do this, and you will live." But wanting to justify himself, the man asked Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" Jesus replied, "A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell into the hands of robbers, who stripped him, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. Now by chance, a priest was going down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, while traveling, came near him, and when he saw him, he was moved with pity. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, having poured oil and wine on them. Then he put him on his own animal, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, and said, 'Take care of him, and when I come back, I will repay you whatever more you spend.' Which of these 3 do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robbers?" The man said, "The one who showed him mercy." Jesus said to him, "Go and do likewise." This is the gospel of the Lord. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be always acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our redeemer. It is one of Jesus' best-known teachings, given in his favorite teaching mode, the parable. The parable, that short classic story which is meant to teach a lesson everyone hearing him could understand, from the simplest to the greatest, and a story which often packed a punch. If we are familiar with this story, sometimes we need to approach it from a different angle, from a different perspective. So this sermon will be a little different. Just what you wanted to hear on a Sunday morning. This will be a little different. For 2 summers in college, I worked as a hotel desk clerk. So I have often wondered how the innkeeper experience this story. I have written a meditation from his perspective. You see a lot of life as an innkeeper. The people who are running away from something, the people who are on their way to something and just stopping by, The people who treat you as a mere inconvenience as they head to their room. The people who really want to talk and are looking for someone to hear their story. I've seen all of that and more in my inn along the Jericho Road. But there was one occurrence that really changed me, changed my outlook and even my perspective on being a human being. I remember when we built that little inn there along that famous road from Jerusalem to Jericho. We really are a little oasis. The road drops about 3,200 feet in a little over 18 miles. It twists and turns. It seems you meet yourself going and coming. So robbers love it. There are lots of crannies to lie in wait for unsuspecting travelers. You can pounce on them and be gone. I can't tell you the number of times I have literally seen relief when people have walked through our doors. Their shoulders relax. They know they are safe, and they're ready for a meal and something to drink. Like everyone else, I always accepted some things pretty much as fact, things that I didn't question too much. Being a Jew, I knew that the people of Samaria, the Samaritans, had deserted us. They had left us, the chosen people. They believed wrong. They only followed the first five books of the Bible. They believed that this mountain called Gerizim was the true place to worship, not the temple in Jerusalem. Imagine the chutzpah. You know, a few years back, some of that Samaritan rabble had even entered our temple in Jerusalem and scattered bones around. That had desecrated the temple. It had to be cleansed afterward. My uncle even said that the only good Samaritan was a dead Samaritan. And yet, there I was at the inn one day, late afternoon, hot day, flies buzzing around, ready for that hot sun to set, ready for someone else to take over, when in comes this Samaritan. I wanted to tell him to leave, that he wasn't welcome here. But he was carrying a Jewish man on his back. My first thought was that he had probably beaten him up. But why would he be dragging him in here? Why didn't he just take his money and run? I just stood there shocked as he carefully placed the man on a cot and told me that robbers had beaten this man and he had come upon him after other people had passed by. I could see where the Samaritan had washed the man's wounds, and he had bandaged him with strips of his own clothing. The Samaritan told me that he would pay all of the man's expenses, that the man was to stay here until he was well. And then the Samaritan was gone. I can tell you that it didn't make sense to me. But I found the poor man a room. We were able to get him something to eat, and he slept late the next morning. By the evening of the next day, he told me his story. How he had seen this guy coming his way, how he didn't have a good feeling about the situation, how he realized he had nowhere to go, how this other guy was pretty big, how he came up to him and just hit him. Then hit him again, and then snatched his money pouch and ran. My new friend told me about the heat, about the pain, about how thirsty he was, about how he realized he might just die there along that road. heard footsteps. He could tell by the robes that a priest of the temple was coming. The footsteps grew closer, but they didn't slow down, and the man kept going. He then realized that the priest probably thought he was dead. And he knew the priest couldn't touch a dead body or he would be impure, and he would have to go through a whole ritual of purification. It just wasn't worth it for someone who was probably dead anyway. Then, footsteps again. Through his bruised eye, he guessed that this was someone of the tribe of Levi, someone with authority in the temple. Maybe this one would stop. But again, the footsteps kept their rhythm. This one must avoid defilement too, he knew. Finally, more footsteps. He looked up, unbelieving, and he could tell it was a Samaritan. Well, this is really the end, he thought. This guy will just finish the job. What a great chance to kick a wounded Jew. Finish me off. No one would ever know. His people would probably cheer him on. How did I ever get in this situation? But then he told me he felt water on his lips. He felt the man's hand gently under his neck. He smelled wine being poured on his wounds. He heard the man ripping his own clothing and saw him putting bandages on his wounds. The Samaritan then picked him up, put him on his donkey, and headed off. My friend had no idea where the Samaritan was taking him or why. Was he being kidnapped or worse? Could he be some sort of trophy for this Samaritan to bring home? But then he woke up here in my inn, and I told him the rest of the story. How the man had placed him tenderly on the couch. How he had paid all of his expenses, and how he will be coming back. At this, my friend started to weep. Deep, heaving sighs of relief, of guilt, maybe of hope that the world was not as he had always been taught. I have to say, I started to weep too. I started to wonder whether reality was bigger and deeper than I had been led to believe. I felt a strange kinship with a Samaritan. I had seen with my own eyes that they, even they, were capable of good. They shared that trait with my people. They are more like us than I ever thought. What do I do with that man? How do I treat them now? Are they my neighbors? This story from our Lord takes on yet new urgency this week. We have seen in our country yet more horrible violence. Violence which in every case, in one way or another, involved a breakdown in the capacity of seeing someone different as a neighbor. The policeman scared to death as someone reached for identification, as a black man reached for identification. The police on top of a homeless black man. A black man so driven by hate for white people, especially for white policemen, that he slaughtered innocent policemen on duty in a completely different city in retaliation for the killings of the two black men. What are we as Christians to do? This parable of the Good Samaritan so well known and loved, can come across as sentimental or sweet. In essence, saying, just go play nice in the sandbox. But it really is hard work and a high calling. It calls us to remember that all human beings are created in the image of God, that all people are capable of both good and evil, of glory and of shame. Sometimes we have to dig deeper or go out of our way to see that image, even with ourselves, as it can get pretty marred. But it is still there. As Colossians 1:27 has it, Christ in you, the hope of glory. An amazing photo emerged from the horrific shootings in Dallas. It was a photo of a group of strangers of many different races encircling a baby stroller to protect that baby during the shooting. If you pay attention in moments of humanity at its worst, you can often also see humanity at its best. Perhaps one of our chief callings as Christians in this parish and in our individual lives is to ask this question today, this week, and for the rest of our lives. Who is